Welcome to the Prevailing Prayer Podcast with award-winning Christian authors Alana Terry and Jaime Hampton. The Prevailing Prayer Podcast, changing the world one prayer at a time.
Hey guys, Alana Terry here. Welcome to the Prevailing Prayer Podcast.
We are doing something a little different for the summer. We are going to be airing episodes that we haven't aired in a while, some of our earliest and some of our favorite episodes. So this week, we're going to bring back prayer journaling, which I am really not an expert on, but Alana is just an amazing prayer journaler, and I learned a lot just doing this episode with her. I gained a lot of tips for prayer journaling, so is one of my favorite episodes.
Yeah, it is one of the, I think it was one of our like very first batch we ever recorded. So hopefully it will be a blessing to you guys. The reason we are doing some reruns isn't just because we want to revisit some old information, but Jaime and I are going to be spending the summer working on some resources in addition to this podcast that we're really excited about. So if you want to make sure that you don't miss out hearing about that, make sure that you've subscribed to our email list at alanaterry.com/subscribe.
And we are just going to jump right into opening up with a word of prayer before our rerun, but still extremely relevant podcast episode. Thanks for being here with us. Father, we just thank you so much for the opportunity to be here to glorify you in this podcast and just in this discussion about this topic of prayer journaling. We just pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to what you have for us today so that we would be able to enter into a deeper relationship with you through journaling. And we just thank you and just pray that you would bless this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. We're going to start with our psalm of the day. This comes from Psalm 63. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you.
Thank you for that. Now we are going to talk about our meditative morsel. That's the part of our podcast where we bring you a quote from a church leader about prayer. And this quote is from S.D. Gordon. And it says, prayer strikes the winning blow. Service is simply picking up the pieces.
I think that's fabulous. I think, you know, it's a great picture that prayer is never our last resort. I think it's such a misnomer when Christians say, well, I guess all we can do now is pray or something like that. Because just like he says here, prayer is what wins the battle and what gains us the victory. Everything that we do from there and all the service and ministry that happens is, like he says, it's picking up the pieces that were won in that posture of prayer.
I think so too. And just having that victory mindset, I think, helps us in those acts of service. And I think as we pray, it kind of directs our service and it helps us to gain God's eyes and just helps us to be directed in the different ways that we need to be doing things. And he shows us where the pieces are that need to be picked up. And I think sometimes when we go about it the other way, where we're trying to bend God to our will, I think we miss out on power that comes from this kind of prayer.
Absolutely. And I think the other way that we kind of get it backwards often is that we do the ministry and we do the service and, you know, we wonder why it's not effective. And we've forgotten that, again, the battle is won through prayer. And I think it's also a team effort. You know, we sometimes think of it, well, here's my pastor going out and doing his work for God, or here's the missionary our church has sent out and they're doing their work for God. And we forget that we're the backline support system. And if you don't have that, you know, in any kind of battle, you're not going to gain the victory that you're looking for. So speaking of victory in spiritual battles, we're going to jump to our persecution spotlight, which is where in this show we want to bring you highlights and news and testimonies too from what's going on in the persecuted church around the world. So this is a recent update from Open Doors, which is a neat ministry that supports persecuted believers around the world. And this is the story of Pastor Odana, who is from the Central African Republic, where there's been a lot of political unrest and guerrilla warfare and rebels fighting, trying to overthrow things. And so he and his family were in this line of fire from this rebel group. And the troops actually came and occupied his home. And what I love about this story is it was the local Muslim imam, which is kind of their equivalent of a pastor. And he's the one who warned these rebels away. He said, this is the house of a servant of God. So you're going to be cursed if you take over it. And I think it was just a neat story how even the imam was able to appreciate that God was watching out for this family. And, you know, just that God can bring us victory and support from so many different people, you know, not even necessarily from believers, but that it's his spirit who is protecting us no matter how that comes. And in the realm of spiritual warfare, you know, he can grant us that victory in so many different ways. So speaking of victory, let's just go ahead and take a minute to pray for the people like Pastor O'Donnell who are on the front lines. Let's remember that we're not just the people left back home to wish them well. We are as much soldiers for the cross as they are. And we're the ones who are providing them with that prayer backup support without which they're not going to experience the victory that we were just talking about. So God, thank you so much that you are the King who grants us victory. You're the conquering warrior, Father God, and you're also the Prince of Peace. So we pray that your peace would reign in the hearts of people like Pastor O'Donnell and other missionaries and pastors and evangelists living in rebel-occupied territories or war-torn regions, God. We pray that you would continue to watch over their safety, Lord, that whether they turn to the right or to the left, it would be your hand that is guiding them, that they would not feel fear, that their families would be protected and kept safe, and that you would be looking out for their physical well-being and their emotional needs. For those who have children, Lord, I pray that the children would be protected and not fearful as well, and that everyone surrounding them would see the peace that you give, and that you would grant them that spiritual victory over the darkness that they're facing today. Amen.
Amen. Our prayer adventure today is someone that many of you have heard of. He's a missionary, Hudson Taylor, and he's the founder of China Inland Mission. And on the way to China for the first time, he was sailing and they found themselves dangerously close to the north of New Guinea, and they were heading toward these sunken reefs that were going to put their boat in danger. And not only that, they were really close to where there were known to be cannibals. So if they found themselves shipwrecked, they were going to be in a really bad spot. So at this point, Hudson Taylor knew that the captain was a believer. And so he gathered the captain and a couple of others on the boat that were also Christians to pray. And they decided to pray for wind. They were at a place where the winds were known to die down during the day completely, and they would pick up in the evenings. But at this point, they had no hope for wind. And Hudson Taylor knew that God can do anything. And so he gathered these Christians together and they prayed for wind. And the quote that I read said that at the point that they prayed for a while, and he got to a point where he felt so satisfied that our request was granted that I could not continue asking. So at this point, Hudson Taylor just had that assurance that we hear from so many of the great Christians in history, where George Mueller and some of these others, where they just have this faith that what they'd asked for was going to be accomplished and had already been accomplished. So immediately he had the first officer let down the corners of the mainsail. And this first officer was not a believer and didn't understand because there was no wind at this point. But Hudson Taylor told him, let down the sails. This wind is coming. And he had so much faith that he asked for the corners of the mainsail to be let down, just kind of as proof of that belief. And as you may have figured out, God did send the wind and they were saved.
I love that conviction, you know, and I definitely think there's a point in time where we come to God humbly with our requests. And I also think that sometimes he gives that boldness into our spirits, that conviction that we are praying according to his will and that he will answer us, or maybe he's already answered us. I think that's a great picture. So thanks for sharing that story. We're going to jump to our nuts and bolts section. And today, like I mentioned before, we're talking about prayer journaling. And it's not something that everybody does. And definitely on this show, we don't want to make it sound like there's a one size fits all. If you want to be someone who's growing in their prayer life, you've got to do it exactly like this. What we want to do is throw a bunch of tools at you to see what's going to help you in your prayer life. And so for those of you who have never kept a prayer journal, we want to start by just talking through some of the benefits of it and why you might want to choose to do it. I think for me, the biggest benefit of keeping a prayer journal is it helps fight off distraction and it keeps me focused. So if I want to say I'm going to set aside 5 minutes to pray, and it doesn't sound like much, but for those of you who have done that, it's very hard to stay completely focused for any amount of time. And it's a lot easier for you to start off praying and then your mind wanders and then you remember, oh yeah, I'm supposed to be praying. But when you're actively writing in a prayer journal, it's kind of a visual as well as a physical reminder of what you're supposed to be doing, which is praying. And I really like that aspect of it.
I do too. I have a very hard time staying focused doing anything and I get really easily distracted. So I think that's a really good benefit of prayer journaling. Another benefit that I've found over the years is that a prayer journal kind of serves as an Ebenezer or like a memorial stone of where you've been and how far you've come as you look back on those prayers that you've prayed and you see that they've been answered, or as you read your conversations with the Lord and you see how you've grown. I think that's definitely a benefit. Another thing though is it could be a challenge because I've looked back at prayer journals before and been humbled at my relationship with God at that time. And I think I'm not that close to God anymore. Or, you know, I wish I had that kind of faith, or I was really focused on praying for other people. Why am I not that focused on that now? So I think you can both see where you've grown and you can also see ways that you could grow a little bit more as you look back. College is really when my prayer journaling began in earnest. I had a friend that gave me the gift of a prayer journal, and I had never done that. I'd written diaries before, but she gave me this prayer journal, and I wrote in it kind of like a diary, and then I would write prayer requests at the end. And I had never in my life seen God work in such amazing ways. It grew my faith so much because as I wrote those prayers down and I focused on what my desires were and what I was requesting of God, I was able to look back and, you know, just even days or weeks later and see God working in big ways.
That's neat. And I like what you said about, you know, how you can see not only the prayers that God's answered for you, but, you know, your own spiritual journey. You know, whether you might look back and say to yourself, wow, I was so close to God at that point. Or maybe you look back and you say, wow, I was so selfish in the things I was praying for. It does give you a chronicle of where you've been and where you've come from. But there are also many stumbling blocks to prayer journaling. One of the biggest ones for me is, you know, kind of my perfectionism. Like, to me, there is nothing more intimidating than starting a brand new blank journal, whether I'm talking about a prayer journal or, you know, the journals I jot my notes in for the books I'm writing or things like that. It's very intimidating. And what I find to be the most freeing is once I've made my first mistake and just have to scratch something out, it kind of frees me up because I realize, okay, this isn't going to look perfect. And that's okay, because that's not the point. But, you know, for some people, that sense of perfectionism can be really hard. Another one for me is privacy. You know, I don't want to be writing my deepest, darkest secrets out to God or, you know, confessing all these sins when I'm worried that one of my kids is going to pick up the book and start reading through it or something. So if that's something that you also worry about, I just have a really funny tip to show you guys. And I know if you're listening to the podcast, I'm just going to explain it to you. But if you're actually watching on YouTube, I want to show you. This is an actual page from my prayer journal. And no, not all of my pages look like this, but this is where I list out some of my confessions and my sins and also some of the things I'm really grateful for and just things on my heart. And these are things that, you know, on the one hand, it might be nice to have a chronicle of later on, but I feel freer when I know that, you know, nobody's going to stumble upon it and have a good laugh at all of my sins and things that I'm confessing to God. And so what I do is I just pick a day. And for that entire day, I write my whole prayer on one line. So I'm just writing over the exact same line over and over and over so that two or three lines into it, nobody, myself included, is going to be able to read it. Because for me, it's more important for me to be able to get those things out and to kind of pray them while I'm writing them than it is to have a record that I could look back in 10 years or something, you know. And like I said, I don't do every page like that. There are definitely times where I do write out the things I'm praying for, and it is neat to go back and see how those have been answered. But for the really juicy stuff, it just makes me feel freer to be myself and not have to worry about, you know, self-censoring because someone might pick it up and read it.
I can relate to that. I have had several journals that I've actually thrown away or shredded before I threw them away or ripped pages out of or scribbled until they couldn't be recognized because there just are those really private things. I like the idea that you have one area where you can write those things down that are private that you know in advance that you're not going to want other people to see, and then another journal where you can write down things that you'd like to go back and look on. That's really good. I think for myself, I've been really bad about prayer journaling over the last couple of years. And for me, I think the roadblocks have been that I feel like I don't have enough time for a prayer journal, or I just really, the reality is I'm not making it a priority because there is enough time in the day. I could easily do it. I could gain 5 or 10 minutes here or there and make it a priority. I think that is a really big roadblock to a lot of people. So I think number one is recognizing the benefits. And for me, I really do want to start doing a prayer journal. And I actually think I'm going to start with the one that we're offering, Alana, the Prevailing Prayer Journal. I got that PDF today, actually, and I'm going to start using that to kind of jumpstart my prayer journaling. But I think sometimes we just don't know. Some people, if you don't like to write, or if you just don't know how to do it or where to start, it just seems intimidating. You get this blank piece of paper, and kind of like you said, it's intimidating just having this brand new journal or even a sheet of paper, or if you're typing it on the computer and thinking, what do I even write? Do I talk to God? Do I write it like a diary entry? Do I just list off people? How do I do this? And I think what we're here to share with you is there are so many ways to do it. Just pick one that works for you. And there's no right or wrong way. Prayer journaling itself isn't biblical. It's not something that is gospel. It's something that's a tool that if you choose to use it, it could really deepen your prayer life. It could deepen your relationship with God. But you're not doing it wrong if you're not doing it, or if you're doing it one way and someone else does it another way. It's totally up to you. It's whatever works for you to draw you closer to the Lord. And I think that's what we definitely want to get across today.
And with that being said, you know, let's just talk about the different types of prayer journaling, because there are so many different ways to do it. So there's sort of the diary format, which is where you just, you know, kind of start each day, dear God. You can do anything that's on your heart, the people you want to pray for, the things that you're going through. I think one of the benefits of that way, I feel like when I was real religious about keeping kind of a prayer diary in that sense, I think were some of the most intimate ways I've used a prayer journal. Because really, it is whatever is on your heart, and you're talking just to God, and there's no magic formula. It can also end up being kind of self-centered, which again, isn't necessarily a bad thing, but again, you don't want your prayers to be lopsided either, so that all you're talking about is you, 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 you. So, you know, but that's just one way to do it. You can write out your prayers for other people. It's a good way to make sure you're being very thorough about it, because you can cover a lot of topics. For some people, though, that just feels like a very long way to do it. So some people prefer sort of the list method. That's what I've been doing a little bit more of lately. And that can just be something as simple as each day, you just want to jot a list of the people or the issues you're praying about. You can be as fancy as you want. I know at one point I even created a prayer scrapbook where I would cut out pictures from magazines or current events or things like that of issues that I wanted to pray for. And we'd also included pictures of family members and stuff like that. Again, not everybody has time to do that, but if you do, and if you're crafty like that, that's another really neat way, because you're not only praying for them as you make it, but you're also praying through those things. And now you have a tool that you can pray through on a daily basis. It's going to, you know, kind of be a real simple checklist. These are the people or issues I want to pray for. And again, there's everything in between. Some people like to have different pages for different issues. That's kind of how I do it now. I've got a page for the unsaved friends that I want to pray for. I have a page of prayer requests that are more related to my writing and my novels. I have a page that's just for gratitude. These are all the things I want to tell God I'm thankful for every day. So again, there's not any right or wrong way, but these are just some tools that might help you when you're getting started out.
And Alana and I have actually put together a tool, a resource for you if you're interested in starting to prayer journal, or if you are at a place where you are looking for some resources to help you focus your prayer journaling time. And it's the Prevailing Prayer Scripture Journal. And you can find it at alanaterry.com/prayer journal. And it's a free PDF that you can get. And like I said, I'm going to start doing it myself. And just the process of working on it was a huge blessing to me. So I'm excited to go through it as a reader. So We hope that you'll take advantage of that.
Absolutely. So we're going to move on to the global petition part of the show. And this is where we want to just bring to mind some of the issues going on around the world that we should be holding in our prayers. And one of the real hot button issues of today is the refugee crisis. And when I say hot button, it's not so much that people in the U.S. are angry at each other about it. I'm talking about hot button because there are families and kids and elderly and people with disabilities who truly have nowhere to go. And regardless of what you feel like our government should be doing for these people, we definitely need to be petitioning God to be watching over the needs of these refugees. So, you know, a lot of us think of refugees as living in big, squalid camps where you can imagine there's all kinds of crime and violence. A lot of them, that does happen. And then there are also many who end up just kind of as squatters in the cities of the countries where they've fled to. In both of these cases, it's really hard for them to find work. Most of the time, they're in the country they're at illegally, and so they can't find legal work. The kids have very few educational opportunities. Plus, you know, by the time you are a refugee in this situation, you can imagine what sort of trauma and fear you've had to go through. So let's take a minute today to pray for these refugees. And as you go throughout the rest of your day, even once this podcast is over, try to remember to be lifting these people up in your prayers too. God, we thank you that you are the father to the fatherless, that you defend the orphans and the widows. I thank you so much that throughout the Old Testament, you were so compassionate towards the foreigners and the outsiders, and you made so many of your laws to be providing for them, God. And today, we just lift up all of these refugees who have been displaced by war and terror, that you would bring comfort to their hearts, that you would be preserving their families, that you would be healing the trauma that they've had to endure, that you would be providing for all of their spiritual and physical needs. God, we pray for the political answers, and we have no idea what they are, God, but we know that you can make a way so that these people can either return to their homes in safety or find new homes where they can live in peace and take care of their families. We pray especially today for the children who are living in refugee camps or who are displaced. Lord, please give them the physical resources they need to stay healthy. Please protect them from predators. Please protect them from the fear that they've had to live through. We pray that they would be getting the educational opportunities that they need, God. We pray that your gospel would spread throughout these refugee communities as well, Lord, that you would look down on these people who have so much trauma and fear, and that you would show them that you are the way and the truth and the life. We pray that you would be blessing the workers who are ministering to refugees, that you would keep them safe and give them the spiritual and emotional stamina they need to continue on in their ministry. And God, we just pray for an end to these wars that have made these people displaced in the first place, God, that you would settle these regions so that they could return to their homes. Amen.
Amen. Well, if you were with us last week, you know that we posed a challenge for you to choose one or maybe two or up to five people that you know that you would commit to praying for over pretty much forever until they come to the Lord. So it sounds like a big challenge, but we wanted to start with small numbers. And so during each podcast, we're going to give you an opportunity to pray along with us. And I have taken one of the prayers from 30 Days of Prayer for the Unsaved that Alana has put together. And I'm going to read through this and fill in the blank with just a general term for the person or people that you're praying for, with the idea that you are going to be praying for those people that the Lord has brought to your mind. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the love that you have for my friend. Thank you that you can give them the faith that they need to be saved. Please help them in their unbelief, Lord. Help them to seek after you and you only. Settle any doubts they still have about your power, your love, or your goodness. Where there is doubt, replace it with the gift of faith. Apart from you, my friend could never be saved, but you are the giver of every good and perfect gift, including the faith that saves us. Please grant that faith to my friend today so that where there was once doubt, there would be a firm and unshakable conviction of you and your love and power. Only you can do this, Lord. Please use my prayers for my friend to increase my own faith as well, and let me be faithful in my intercession. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. And we want to leave you guys with a blessing and a benediction today. But before we do that, I just want to give you that website one more time if you wanted to grab that prayer journal we're offering. It's at alanaterry.com/prayer journal. And your blessing today says, may the word of God dwell in you richly, guiding you, leading you in the way you should go. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, may God's word be a light for your path and a lamp to your feet. May his word fill you with the knowledge of his will and thoroughly equip you for every good work.
And our benediction today comes from Revelation 7:12. Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.